So Thomas and I are going to tell you about the student cluster contest, the cluster that we're building this summer. And it's mostly going to be Thomas, because apparently I don't know anything about how to hook up a Mac laptop to a projection system. So, but we're also presenting this tomorrow night, so this will be good. I'll help Thomas out with the presentation. And I think you guys, if you guys remember when Ryan and I did the last month's BLU, I talked a lot about the top 500, the green 500 in this, you know, supercomputing conference in November. That's what this cluster is going to be built for. So, but I'll let Thomas tell you about the design. And then by then we'll pass it off to Brian, who will sort of cover the entire ARM spectrum tonight. We'll have Brian tell you about BeagleBone Black. Oh, you want me to present? Okay. All right, well, you got to present it tomorrow night. I'm not going to be there.
That's why you're presenting tonight.
All right. So.
You have to error.
Okay. All right. Sorry for the layout. Aforementioned laptop problems. But very quickly, because this is mostly going to be a much more ARM-centric discussion. If you look at that URL there, supercomputing, it's the big IEEE conference. At one time, I don't know if this is still true, but it was bigger than all other IEEE conferences combined. I go because I work in high-performance computing. I go to Cluster, which is probably a couple of hundred attendees. It's a U.S. conference. Well, it's normally a U.S. conference. It's U.S. 2 years and then overseas, and then it comes back to U.S. And for those of you who have who know the IEEE conference model, you have a date that you have to send in either an abstract or a full paper by. They look at it, and then they have a deadline, and then they say, okay, we want your camera-ready artwork. You show up, they publish it, or they have a poster session or workshops. That's pretty much the standard model for the high-performance computing conferences, and it's just done in much larger numbers than supercomputing. Supercomputing has dozens of subtracks. Lots of little mini competitions, the Gordon Bell Prize for the, you know, I don't think they still have a performance per watt category anymore, but the raw performance Gordon Bell Prize, they write a paper, a lot of blue gene papers in the Gordon Bell subtrack. And so we routinely submit a student cluster design to the student cluster competition. And this year we sent in a team. We had a team last year that was nominally a consortium of students from BU, Northeastern, MIT, Harvard, and UMass, because the last year was the first year of the Massachusetts Green High Performance Computing Center, which had those five schools as the research consortium. One third of the stool that made the foundation for the Holyoke Data Centers, academia, industry, and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So we said, well, we'll do an MGH PCC team. When we finally got around to taking students out to the conference in November, it was a very BU-centered team. And depending on when finals are this coming year, it may be a BU-centered team again. But we'll get Thomas to help out. Oh, that's true, yeah, so he may not qualify. But what's unique about this year's competition is they have a standard subtrack, which is 26 amps on two 13-amp services that they stick into a nice UPS, so you can violate it if you want to and take the point penalty during the competition. But with the commodity track, the 15 amp power, they give you one AEC cable, one house current cable, and say, knock yourself out. And if you pop, you know, a circuit breaker, you know, we'll get around to turning it back on. It's a 72-hour window that you have to generate these operations per second. So we said, oh, that's fine. We love house current. We're going to see if we can get 16 amps out of whatever they have on the showroom floor in Denver. And then the other two restrictions on this contest was the cost, the $2,500. We may be able to, it's not clear yet how they're gonna quantify that. It may be that they have to be able to put together an invoice to rebuild the cluster based upon our BOM. And we're not sure about that yet. I think the path we're gonna pursue is gonna be sufficient for that. And then the least restrictive is the 6-foot rack, or 72, I think you can bring a 48U rack in if you're so inclined. And I figure that turns out to be about 33,000 cubic inches, because we're going to be shoehorning all sorts of crazy stuff in here just because our boards are real low power. We talked some about the various boards, which are no more than 5 watts, but certainly get down to around 2. Some of these Atom boards, a lot of ARM boards, and some other places that we can get cheap operations per second for, you know, low voltage, low amperage. So, like I say, I won't be here. So there's the problem and the solution. This was going to be a really impressive slide with, if you go to this link, which we may pull up at the end, it's a big, big leering face of Terry Jones from Monty Python. So, now what, so why blancmange? So it's a little bit of a play on words. Remember last month I talked about Mont Blanc quite a bit. So blancmange is a, I guess, a Scottification of the word blancmange. So he said, but more importantly, the history of Monty Python and computer science go way back. I mean, spam, okay? Everyone knows the story of spam. I personally think Bing came from Monty Python. That was my startup sound on my first Macintosh, was, I see you have the machine that goes Bing. Also probably Terry Jones. And then Thomas theorized that in this clip, if you go back to that blancmange clip, it's a Monty Python sketch called the Sci-Fi Sketch, 1968. So there's some scene where someone's reading a book that says Google Withers on it. So Thomas is theorizing that that's where the word Google comes from. I don't know. You can tell him your conspiracy theory
and
there.
Python programming language.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, that's Monty Python.
Okay, believe that one.
That one is like official.
What, Python is?
Python is named for Monty.
Really? I just thought it was the next in the free visual that you get from the O'Reilly database.
Guido von Rossum did say that.
That is Monty Python. I'm kidding. Holy smokes.
Well, that, which is one good thing is poor guys. Favor the language.
Yeah.
Is there anything else?
I don't know. I'll have to look.
Well, I run the pro group. What do you think my opinion is?
All right, so we're going to look at, because we're limited to the, you know, 3100, or excuse me, so closer to 1600 watts. We're going to try some of those designs. I didn't recreate my slides from last month here, but powering things over on-the-go cables,
transfer links,
trying to get both power and some networking out of the on-the-go cables. You're not going to get great networking out of OTG, out of USB net, but you're going to get some. So if you wanted to use your main NIC for interprocessor communication, and maybe NFS for USB, I don't know. We're going to try everything because we're going to get some of these 2U cases, put 48 of these boards in, and a switch maybe. I think our switch is going to be one of these ones that's 48 fast Ethernet ports and 2 gigs out. We don't have anything faster yet on the SBCs, on the development boards. All we got is fast Ethernet. So we're gonna have to try some clever stuff there. Possibly looking at something other than TCP. So it's gonna be a very subjective solution to exactly the problem that they've specified. They need us to run WARF on here, the weather prediction software, NEMO 5, a nano mechanical package, and what was the other one? In fact, does it call up as we should have to do the backspace?
No.
Yeah, Rocky. You think he can not sit too close to the microphone or the camera?
Well, what about right here?
Oh, there's fine, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, there's the list. Yeah. So they also have a category. They always give out 4 applications. This year they've got a mystery application. I don't think it'll be that much of a mystery because the guys who run this competition are long-time computationally, you know, intensive scientists from the national labs. I think we're going to be able to at least bracket the possibilities of what CFD code or what sort of atomistic code they might be doing. So we'll know roughly the direction they're going to go. So we'll find out which part of our infrastructure, we need to stress it's going to be an FFT problem or it's going to be a linear algebra problem or something. So we'll get a little bit smart up there. So if they lay something on us that looks like, you know, single precision linear algebra, we'll be ready for it. This is mostly going to be, we're yanking a lot of open source to solve some of these small problems. Like I say, I think we're going to look at like a lightweight TCP or something. Do you remember the Gamma protocol from a couple of years back? It had all this cool lazy ACK and NACK, and it was good for certain kinds of not very communication intensive applications. And we'll be able to tune this a little bit to mask the communications with the computation. I think we're going to definitely have a lot of computation relative to our potential network. Told you about the top 500. The top 500 and the green 500 happened at supercomputing day 3 or something like that. They come out and they announce the top 500 supercomputers in the world. And then the green 500 guy, maybe the day after, has a list that's reorganized based upon energy efficiency. So his has a ratio. This year it's a safe bet Blue Gene's going to dominate the top end of the list again. They have a very very efficient design. They're already over 2.5 gigaflops per watt. They'll probably be at 3. That's a tall order to meet for a cluster larger than, you know, a dozen nodes. So we'll have to build one. We'll have to see how much we can get, how energy efficient we can get up to 3 kilowatts. I told you something about earlier revisions here. Up until SC, I think SC 11 was the last conference that they had the disruptive technologies subtrack. So we could show something built out of an ARM-based solution. This one was GumSticks, which is the ARM Cortex A8. And we had lots of them. It's just there. That's right. So this was a TI OMAP 3 processor, which shows up in a lot of stuff. Some of the stuff we'll be talking about tonight. BeagleBone originally started out as an OMAP 3 and is now migrated to a TI Zatara architecture. We went to, thanks in no small part to BLU, we had serial number 1 Panda board, and I brought that to supercomputing, and we installed Angstrom on it and tried to do some benchmark testing with it. And then we started clustering Panda boards. I love that Panda board. I wish they kept making it. I think they've discontinued the OMAP 4 line. Is that right? Or
no, so they're still making the 4460s, but in very small collection
boxes. Oh, is that right? Okay.
It's interesting that Google Glass actually uses the 4430.
Oh, it does. So they found like a warehouse full of them.
Motorola's old warehouse. They have already small stuff.
Okay, so Mont Blanc is a big consumer of Samsung CPUs. They plan on building an extremely large ARM Cortex. I think right now they're looking at ARM Cortex A9 based supercomputer at the Barcelona Supercomputing Center in Barcelona. Certainly a very ambitious schedule. I don't think they're currently on track, but they may catch up when this new processor comes out. I bet you want to know about the new processor. So I may fast forward. It's almost 7:30. I'm going to get to. So we've got 3 of the 5 parts of the stack we're trying to fix, you know, memory, processor, networking. Networking is going to be a big problem for us. We've got 2 U's, fast Ethernet per board, which might not be sufficient. I don't know how much we can make the computation and communication even, or to rebalance it so that we can make up for our communication needs.
I think they don't give points for neatness.
No. So the commodity track is absolutely right in our wheelhouse. We could put this on baker's racks if we wanted to, and I think we should, because they baker racks are cheap. We'll be using something like this. You can put with these Kutek USB hubs. It's a 2-amp power supply. I'm still not quite sure how we're getting as much wattage out of this as we did, because Thomas would routinely just unplug the cord and put it back in and stuff like that. And I was like, well, it's no way this thing's just all going to turn on once. I mean, each one of these is half an amp and you know, 5 volts, and yet it was doing it. So those things must not really be rated what they say on the box, because because these things were...
USB 2 is only spec for milliamps, but in consumer products it's 500 up to, you know, 2 amps.
Oh, yeah. So. Yeah. And the future looks great for USB. USB 3 is, you're supposed to use that for power.
It can do, yeah.
And then we wanted to do something exotic, possibly as early as Sunday. Thomas and I have done solar-powered clusters before, and as you know from a couple months back, John Masters has done bicycle-powered clusters. So we don't know what the next big thing is. I truly believe if we get enough potatoes, we could do a potato battery cluster. Because that's already DC, so...
Talk to my relatives in Maine.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
On a more serious note, how about fuel cell? Get the miniature ones now.
Oh, really? Like, what kind of wattage?
They're talking about everything from phones to cars.
Okay.
I have seen a couple of tablet ones, so those are at least 5 watts.
Well, so PoE, there's vendors saying that they're getting 50 watts instead of 25 watts out of 802.3AT, I think it is. I mean, so that's great for us. It's an IEEE spec, so maybe the thing will actually be compatible in the future, you know? and I think they're getting 50 watts instead of 4 because they're using all 4 pins. They're not actually using it to communicate with. They're just using the Ethernet cables for 2 sets of 25-watt power. So, but 25 watts is... probably do us two. I mean, we're just doing 2 U's, 48 nodes, might be able to survive on 25 watts. Certainly 50 watts is too much. So, yeah, we're never gonna hit that threshold before we hit some other threshold. $2,500 ceiling on us might be restrictive.
That's going through a switch. Is there a risk of that damaging switch?
PoE? That's a good question. Well, I think so. We'll have injectors going into the two Gigi ports, and we'll take the injectors and strip off the power before it goes into the switch. So we'll just make a big Hydra-headed Ethernet cable on the switch end. Yeah. I mean, I do have a PoE switch, but we don't need 48 ports worth of PoE. We only need 2 ports worth. Thomas is going to look into some exotic thermal solutions. I don't know if that's probably task number 10 or 11. But I do have, before we get Brian up here, I do have a petition for you, an appeal, or just appeal. If you guys go to this tiny URL, octomom8, I've got this link that I'm not really sure is for general public. That's why I masked it temporarily under a tiny URL. But if you guys go to this and can order us, and when I say order us, it's a pre-order, and Samsung just wants to get some sense on how many people need this new processor. Well, they only announced this today, or I shouldn't say that. They've been shipping the Octos in Europe and GS4s for a while, right?
Oh, 2 weeks.
Okay, yeah. But they only announced the developer access today. So if you guys could, I think what's going to happen is last time we ordered Arndale boards, I said, oh, this is great. We'll build a Beowulf cluster out of Arndale boards, and I signed up for like 100 of them or something. And they came back and they said, oh, everybody thought this was a great product, and we'll allow you to buy 2. Ah. So I was like, well, we missed our opportunity there. So if you guys, there's no commitment here. All you got to do is sign up and say, hey, I want 8. What they'll do is they'll give you some order number, and they'll put you on a long list of people who have said, I want 70 of these. And when they get back to you someday, they'll say, we're going to sell you 2, and here's the price. And at that point, I'll either buy them off of you, or you can just give me the registration code. This is what we did with the only way we could get that early release of Raspberry Pis was doing something similar. You had to, who was in it? Remember, Brian? We had to say what project we were going to work on for Nokia.
Right. Right.
So, coincidentally, it took them so long to ship these things, we actually were working on those projects by the time but we had to sign up for a bunch of different things just to get onesies and twosies.
Another page here, that doesn't say how much it costs.
They're going to give you an arbitrary FedEx cost, too. You can put down $100 and it'll be $40. You can put down $2 and it'll be $40. So that's an estimate that they know is wrong. Anyway, so it's 7:30, I think we'll hand this off to Brian. But if you have any questions about this, I'd really like to use the octos in this cluster instead of, we were thinking of building it out of these Exynos 4412s.
It's not true 8-core, it's two quad-core processors.
Yes.
Yep. So it's a quad-core A7, 1.2 gigahertz per core, and then a quad-core A15, which is 1.5.
Which is perfect.
Yeah.
But we'll be able
you can quad down the A15s and just have it in sleep at like 200 megahertz on the A7.
Yeah. And if, and if the granularity is such, we could clock down the math processors and just use the integer processors for communication. I mean, this is some interesting stuff we could try with there. I don't know if...
But they said it's also support neon and everything else as well. So technically, they could be used for heavy maps.
Oh, yeah. Well, and it's twice the RAM because of the A15 extension. So.
You mentioned earlier about some of the dual glass.
Yeah.
Do you work?
Yes.
How old is it?
The current version actually is fairly open. You're not going to be able to.
Is it possible to shut off all the Google stuff and mostly resist the display?
If you hacked it pretty well, then yeah, possibly.
You're up.
I've worked with a lot of augmented reality where we do stuff. You'd have to be able to use.
So we'll be around later if you want to ask us anything about helping out with the student cluster contest. We
if you need to like set up, keep them down because
the they need six students, and we drive out. We might be driving. It's like November 20th. You take the students out there. You run the contest for 72 hours, and then at the end of it, they decide which team has won. There's only six teams in the the standard track this year. University of Texas won last year with a very new Xeon 5 solution, and they probably got two 2.1 gigaflops per watt, which is great on a 26 amp competition. So, and then prior to that, very sort of mostly single precision GPU solutions were winning the contest. So they, and like last year the K10 was brand new, so there were a lot of K10 solutions last year. Yeah, the
okay, thank you very much, Derek. I don't know if you guys are going to give it a crack at it.
Do you need light?
Brian? No, it's okay.
What was the answer to the troubadour?
Okay, here we go. Great, thanks for coming, thanks for joining in. This will be a pretty interactive kind of presentation discussion. There'll be a few, you know, surprises revealed, a few dumb questions, you know, or dumb answers, I should say. No dumb questions, plenty of dumb answers. The tricky stuff, I'll defer to Kurt or Thomas or somebody else who really knows this stuff. Steven, if you want to jump in and help Kurt fix up the networking stuff, that'd be pretty cool. But Kurt may pull this off yet. We've actually got over in this corner one of these little BeagleBone devices. This is the previous packaging that it comes without. It comes in a box. Okay, so this basically the gist of this talk is about the BeagleBone Black, which is a device from BeagleBoard.org, which is, as I gathered, a nonprofit. That's essentially encouraged, sponsored, supported by TI, but not really funded directly. It's on its own. But it is, there's a close tie because the people who design these boards and the people who produce them also work for TI. Not unlike Raspberry Pi, which is basically primarily the main force behind that is from Broadcom, right? And a senior level architect guy from Broadcom. So this is the BeagleBone Black that we're going to spend the next hour or so talking about. And this it was announced about a month ago. It's shipping. Does anybody have a BeagleBone? Either the current version, black, is it the black or the white? So the white, and that shipped like late 2011 or something like that. Same form factor, same kind of secret sauce for a lot of things. Didn't have HDMI, right? Does have networking on it, Ethernet? We've got a slide that'll go through the different things. It's got a similar sort of processor, a little bit slower. It didn't have onboard.
720 megahertz single core.
Right, so both single core.
That's 1 gigahertz, but it's also ARM v11 versus ARM v. They're using ARM v7 on that. It's a mix of v7 and ARM v8.
Right.
They did something weird with that one.
So there's a lot of ARM talk. I'll just get to the slides here, and actually that's kind of a good segue into some of this stuff. So the idea is teaching a new dog old tricks, and of course so I actually view this as a really revolutionary product. First of all, it's only $45, right? So right off the bat, that alone makes it revolutionary. Secondly, it runs Linux, a version of Linux, distribution of Linux, Angstrom, out of the box, just like you'd expect, right? Which is sort of, another component. So you can download a standard distribution, and then you can just have at it, right? In addition, it kind of blends the processing abilities of Linux with the sort of electronica capabilities of the Arduino. Have people work with the Arduino chips? So show of hands, show of hands, how many people own one or more Arduinos? So, 30% or so, right? In the same way that Arduino comes bundled with an IDE for doing development on it, which is kind of a C-like, Java-like, sort of stuff, and then you just start soldering and plugging wires in and LEDs and motors and having fun with it. The beauty of this board is that you get all that functionality. At the same time, you get a full-fledged Linux distribution that has all the standard, heavy-duty tools that you can work with. And we'll kind of go through that. So these are just, this is my smattering of really revolutionary stuff, at least in the last, I guess. Well, of these, the earliest is the Mac. And 84, give or take. How many
it's
people had
30 years.
What's that?
It's like every 30 years.
Yeah. How many people had a Mac 128K? A few of us, people, we remember. John was there. So there, up on the left is an 8008, kind of one of the Intel early chips, right? Over here, anybody know what this picture is? Right here?
Yeah,
there you go. Do you have one of those?
I think so.
I did too. I languished really hard to, should I get one of those, like there was an Atari at the time, which was sort of the alternative. A couple of $100, but these things, they had these.
I think mine was new.
You think it's yours new?
Yeah.
You may have bought mine used or something like that. There were two models of it. It was a programmable, it had sprites, it had animation, you could do game development. They had cartridges that you plug in that were sort of, essentially ROM. I mean, real ROM, not like the Android ROM stuff that we talked about a few months back. But so here is actually Bill Cosby, hyping the TI-99F4. It's amazing the stuff that we went through back then, right? Did you have your cassette recorder to store your programs?
Well, I never actually used the thing.
There you go. Well, so
I
he was
sort of intercepted when it was being tossed in the dumpster.
Yeah, I actually used it. And so how many people recorded programs on cassettes? There you go. Right, Jerry, right? A few?
Yeah, I did that with an old TRS, really.
Yeah.
Not until we...
Right, I was going to put the Apple II up, but that's another one of these revolutionary things. And clearly Linux was, and that's been around for, when was the first, I Am Here Linux announcement that went out?
1991, I forgot. 91. I have the date.
Right, so, so 20-ish years, right? So this is 30-ish years, this is 20-ish years. And, meanwhile, ARM is kind of, hiding out back in the lands of digital, I think, in Marlboro and these other places, and it went from company to company to company. And eventually now it's over in the UK where it's based, but basically it's reduced instruction set computing, but commercialized very successfully. And so all of us who have phones or devices or somewhere deeply, and at one point in time Intel didn't maybe necessarily own ARM outright, but they certainly owned ARM licenses and things like that, and passed it off and had big investments in this stuff. So it all kind of weaves around down to, and this is the BeagleBone Black, right? And along the way, there was a whole bunch of stuff that happened, right? So, this is just, kind of a chip level view of what some of these devices look like now. By the way, Sunday, there's this whole kind of agenda at armfestival.com. Lots of basically half hour talks. Kurt's arranged just a terrific agenda of people to come talk about what they're doing with essentially low cost. Kurt, you want to make a plug for it? Or
We'll throw up the URL.
So at the end we'll come back to that and we can kind of talk about it. And there's free pizza, so what more can you ask for? But so along comes ARM, and they figured out that you can do more than just have custom builds of ARM working on, you know, all sorts of odd devices, printers or phones or whatever you might have. And eventually somebody figured out, boy, we should port Linux to ARM. And I don't know when the first port was. Anybody get an idea?
To Storm ARM, it was like 1996, 97.
Right. So now we're kind of pulling in almost to, you know, 20 years, 15, 20 years. And for a long time, it was, you know, it was Linux, but it really wasn't Linux, I think, for the most part. And the code was a mess, and I don't think, you know, Linus had sort of accepted the fact that ARM was probably going to be a reasonable platform. At some point in time, it came along, and now, and of course, then you had the Android fork, which was to a certain extent a fork of Linux on ARM. But with this 3.8 release of Linux, really and truly, all this stuff is now being mainstreamed. So as changes go into Linux, they're sort of platform compatible on ARM versus AD86 versus MIPS versus the other. So ARM is really a full-fledged, and given the caveats that Thomas mentioned earlier, all the different levels of ARM instruction sets and stuff like that, it can get pretty complex. I would, you know, this, I think the reason this is kind of revolutionary is because all the stuff with the current generation of chips works now. It wasn't true before. You had to really worry about which version of ARM, and did I have this version of ARM, and you still have to worry about the caveats of vendors who have ARM architectural licenses, and they can basically go in and muck with the instruction sets themselves, and thereby create some compatibilities. But
they're not allowed to do that anymore. Once ARM V8 comes out, they're not allowed to make anything that breaks compatibility.
So all of this is, you know, it's kind of, it's good news in the sense that from this point going forward, it doesn't really matter what goes on behind the scenes. You know, how they make the sausage doesn't matter. It's just how it tastes. And it's all going to be sausage, and it's all going to taste good. So, by the way, ARM Festival, Kurt made this observation. If you do, not that it's a big deal, but you do a Google search on it, and the first logo that comes up is ARM Festival, and the first page of websites that come up, we set this thing up about a month ago. People know what an SoC is, system on a chip. So this is another huge, I don't know what would be declared as the first system on a chip, but just to kind of go through, basically it's a computer on a chip, right? So it's got all of the fundamental capabilities of the chip, which isn't true of the Arduino, like, you know, you're going to be missing memory, you're going to be missing these different capabilities. But increasingly, like with the Sitar and these other chips, it's basically a system on a chip. Slight diversion here. Anybody know who Cecil Howard Green is?
He's the guy who gave us the Green Building.
He is the guy who he's
Cecil
a graduate.
And Ida.
What was that?
Cecil and his wife Ida.
Cecil and the wife Ida. That's right. He was one of the founders of TI, and he was also an MIT grad. So Texas Instruments. Why Texas Instruments is kind of an interesting. How many people have a Raspberry Pi? So, you know, about the same number as. You know, it's kind of a dilemma in terms of, and so I'm not going to go, well, I'm going to go pro Texas Instruments. I think this is a really, really, really good product. $45, can't go wrong. It's great for kids who want to learn Linux. It's great for people who want to have a low-cost, energy-efficient recipe, you know, generator at home. It's really useful. Texas Instruments, how many people have a Texas Instruments calculator? Now, come on. It's the de facto standard. You know, speak. You still have your speak and spell, John. Come on. You still
have your speak and spell.
You still have your speak and spell.
I
did. It was. Anybody have a speak and spell? Yeah, a few. Right. Come on. You can admit it. Anyways, it was one of the first I think it was probably the de facto first electronic game with a display. You kind of typed in words, and it had, you know, text to speech and you know, kind of goofy stuff like that. But Texas Instruments does a lot in focusing on science, technology, mathematics, engineering, and things like that. So they, you know, they sell chips of all different varieties, but they're also kind of into it from an educational standpoint. They've also done some interesting things like, you know, come up with first integrated circuits, and as John and I talked about, the TI-99 foray. Just background stuff on Texas Instruments. So, the Beagle Revolution. There have been these different releases of the Beagle board. They've used different chips, and you know, so starting in 2008 is when this kind of thing started. It's just a couple of people at TI who had the idea that you know, we should be able to put systems together that are essentially low-cost reference designs. By the way, the other reason this is, I think, revolutionary, it's an open design. Anybody could take their, you know, essentially their designs, their plans, buy the chips, and manufacture your own. So it's truly, you know, which is not, and it's all open source, truly open source. Unlike if there's a device, and the downside, I think, of the Raspberry Pi is that it's got binary blobs that are not open source, that if you have problems with, you may or may not be able to get them fixed by third parties. But you can't go in and fix them yourself. With this board, everything, you know, it's basically there are no hidden corners that you can get lost in. So the BeagleBone Black is the latest one. We won't go through it. The slides will be available afterwards. If you really want to go through it, there's the white and the black. One thing that is, you know, there are a bunch of things that remain standard, right? So these risers, what do you call them on the side? The headers, thank you. So they're I.O. basically. They give you the ability to plug in little, you know, LEDs or wires or and programmatically activate them, turn them on, turn them off, read in inputs from sensors. These are standard on both devices. So there's a lot of similarity over the years that where things have remained steady and standard. See if I can see what else is here. Still 5 volts, you know, still basic USB, and still, you know, low voltage. This thing, I haven't managed to get it up over 5 watts of power consumption. Generally, when it's idling, it's at a couple of watts, which also gets to be interesting because now you can suddenly do things with just off-the-shelf batteries.
Is it up serial and JTAG?
It does. You would have to actually get the pins, but it's not accessible.
So it doesn't have like a header. I think the old board had like USB serial thing.
Yeah. So, I mean, if you want to describe what it changed, right? So, it's not the same as it was in the white one, and the pinouts are there, but the connector isn't. Okay. And so, what they've done instead is they've basically they've moved it forward so that all the serial I/O takes place just over USB. So it's and I'll show you a demo of this. In fact, as we talk, I'll plug this in right now. So you don't need the JTAG like you used to for kind of getting in there and getting yourself out of trouble, as I understand it. It's a pretty weak way to... When we did the Marvell Lashiva plug stuff, you really couldn't do anything without the JTAG. You know, everything had to be fed into the device via this special cable, which cost you an extra $35 or something like that. On this device, it's all USB. Okay. So I'll plug it in as we talk, and we can see what happens. So did I miss anything here? It's got 1000 Ethernet. It's got micro HDMI, which is huge. The fact that you can plug in an HDMI, it doesn't come with a micro HDMI cable, which is kind of a nuisance. And how many people have a micro HDMI cable? A few, right? So a handful. I just was lucky because I had like bought a Zoom a few years ago, and it came with a micro HDMI cable. But you know, they're only like $3, but it doesn't come in the box.
First time I've heard anyone say they were lucky to buy a Zoom.
Well, it was good for the cable. The Zoom is a good device. It didn't get
my cable took like 8 weeks to ship over from China.
The cables?
Yeah.
It took me 2 days from Amazon, but they're like $3 from Amazon.
All cables I needed didn't exist in Amazon.
Oh, okay. For micro HDMI? You can get them at Amazon now, which is nice. But again, you couldn't a year ago, probably. So.
Well, Amazon had some cables. They just had the bottom vendor on them.
Cables are a nuisance, so I'm all in favor of getting rid of cables. Will BeagleBone Black sell? I think it's a question at the end of the night I'd be interested in asking you folks. Do you think people will buy it? I know I've bought 8 of them already, right? So I'm doing my part to pump the numbers. I just think they're really, really nifty devices. There's a lot of stuff out there. We'll get to it. Okay. So what this is here, BeagleBone 101. I'll just see if I can do this live. And my USB terminology isn't really good. So but basically what I just did was I plugged in the USB port to this. This is a mini or a micro USB?
Micro.
It's a micro. Okay. So it's micro, mini, and just the regular. Okay, so we've plugged this in, and with the there's no power. It's getting the power off of the USB. The lights light up and stuff like that, and it actually gets sound, which is pretty cool. And so it showed up. So it's now appeared on my desktop, and it did have to install a driver. It was a little bit, you know, squishy. It took a few minutes to do. It does automatically download updates, which is pretty cool. But it worked cleanly, and from what I've read on the internet anyways, it works well for all the different people, you know, and the different platforms as well. Haven't tried it on Linux, but or Mac, but it's supported for both. So essentially it shows up as an external drive. But now, and this is like where the JTAG magic starts to happen, that they totally, I'm totally lost. I have no idea how this. So now I'm just going to launch, just going to open up a web page, basically, right? So I'm in this web page, and you go down and it tells you, you know, different things that you need to do. I've already done this, so hopefully I won't have to. Oh, and smartly, you just saw it turn green, right? So I have no idea how it did that, but you saw it first, right? So what it's done is it's talked to this device, and it said, okay, he's got the drivers installed, which is step, well, he's plugged in, first of all, that's good. And then step two is it checks to see, okay, he's got the drivers installed, that's good. And now it says browse to the web server on the board. And I'm thinking, there's no wireless, there's no Ethernet, but I'm going to browse to a web server. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll browse to a web server and see what happens. So you go down here.
Did it set up a subnet over the USB?
It must.
That makes more sense.
That's what it does.
It does that. Yeah, well, I didn't think you could do that.
No, this is OTG.
I mean,
this is... So maybe you could explain that, Kurt.
So you've got host mode USB. So when you plug that thing in, you should see what happens when you plug it in with Mac. It looks like fireworks. It's like, hey, do you want to treat this as a drive or a musical device or something? So that's what that's got going on. And you could even do that with no memory on there. It's built in. Like, if you've got a Panda board with no SD card, no eMMC, it's polling.
It's the actual USB controller that tells it what to do.
Yeah.
And push and pull.
So, you know, again, folks, $45, it's doing fireworks for you, okay?
Yeah.
And so here, what we're going to do is we're going to click on this, and, you know, so now, over USB, we're on this website. It now it knows your board's connected, right? And it's just like, you know, beyond belief to me what this thing does. Okay, so we're going to go down now, and it's essentially, this is an educational tool now for programmatically working with the board. So whereas the Arduino has a very similar setup, right? So where you connect via USB, you do programming. It's not this tightly coupled, particularly not with a web browser, right? And the other thing, and we'll just step through this and maybe do just a very brief demo and then move on to other things. But the approach that they've taken with the out-of-the-box programming experience is using what they refer to as bone script. So it's a variation, it's JavaScript, in essence, with a library that knows how to talk to the BeagleBone device. I have no idea how it does it, but it's very approachable, and one of the big things that they have done, which is just pretty very impressive, is they've got this IDE, which they, have people heard of Cloud9? So what is it? Have you heard of any idea? I'm not sure. So this is, so it's still there. I was just using it. Okay. So we've now jumped out. I mean, now we're on the internet someplace, right? We're at 192.168.7.2. Unless maybe what it is it's a local. That's the local network that's set up here?
Yeah.
That's all right?
Yeah, that's a local network. It's not writable.
Okay. So it's, well, actually it is writable.
Routable.
Okay, so it's not writable. Okay, I buy that.
So there's one live over there if you want to get that URL out.
What's that?
That's 18.2.186.184. Anybody can get on the BeagleBone over there.
That's my BeagleBone. I don't want anybody getting on it. Why don't you give that out? Change it. Password protected. Oh my gosh. Okay. Well, anyways, there goes the neighborhood. Okay. So let's see what this is. Maybe file open. Let's see if this. Nothing. Why didn't it?
Well, you haven't created any files yet.
Yeah, I did. What do these files read here?
You sure agree on this one or not the one over there?
No, this is all local.
it's all local. So what we'll do is we're gonna, I'm just going to cheat and I'm going to recreate. I'm not quite sure why it's not. But what we can do is this accomplishes the point. You it's a little hard to see, but basically the idea is you can take your programs and you can develop them right in this IDE, and you can save them. My experience is you can't retrieve them, but that's okay. you can write them. This is write once key, and then you've got an IDE. It actually is pretty nice looking, but then you can integrate these programs into a web browser, and so you can run the applications right here. Okay, so this is again, I think, a pretty revolutionary step forward in terms of having a ready-made interactive development environment that you can work with, albeit this isn't my preferred mode of operation. Okay, so to this point, what we've shown is we've shown, again, $45. We haven't even connected it to the network yet. Thomas threw out a couple of acronyms, or Kurt did, the EMMC stuff. So it has onboard. What does EMMC stand for?
Embedded
Memory Management Controller or something. It's got a lot of onboard memory. That is writable and readable, and it's also got like a gigantic
and pretty fast,
right? And so you can kind of program it, you can access it, you can interact with it. It's got this JavaScript like language for programming it, and it still only costs $45, but it's only half the story. So we'll take it from here. Any questions to this point? Okay, what's that? The RAM, I think it's got, is it, well, let's go back. I think it's 512.
What are the biggest differences between this and the Raspberry Pi?
Maybe somebody can just search the web and find and get the memory specs on it. But I think it's 512, and I actually think it's 2 gig for
2 gig for the onboard flash memory.
For the onboard flash, which is more kind of geared towards the system and stuff like that. What I haven't done, what Kurt and I have talked about, is what I would really like to do is peel back, get rid of a lot of the Angstrom stuff. I mean, you can browse the internet with your browser, the other thing is Angstrom. Anybody use Angstrom? What's the packaging system? What we want to describe that? It's not apt-get. It's not.
It's an iPackage.
Yeah. They call it OPackage. At least that's been my experience. But
well, is it OPackage now or?
No, used to be iPackage. I haven't dealt with it for a couple of years. I don't know if they changed it, but it used to be iPackage.
This week it's OPackage, but it could be ZPackage next week. But it's a variant that you can get familiar with, and it's got some cluster of software that you can download and install. One of the things is it doesn't have a real-time clock on it, which is a little bit of a nuisance. And I'm sure the smart move was, we don't want to put a real-time clock because we don't want to put a battery because we don't want the weight and the cost and all this other kind of stuff. So, one of the first things after you figure out you need to buy an HDMI cable if you don't have it, the next thing is you got to figure out how can I automatically set the time on this thing, because doing it manually every time is a bit of a nuisance. But
NGP.
What's that?
NGP, if you've got access to the network.
Yeah, so the trick is, like write WTemp after you reboot, and then I mean, even if you've got a 2-day drift or something like that, it's not gonna die for that, and you'll eventually get NTP to your site.
So that's how I did it. And so there was an old package thing that you download, and you kind of go through the steps and you figure it out, and it's reasonable. So if somebody who's fairly naive on the scale of can do it, it's doable. John asked the question about how does it compare to the Raspberry Pi, and so I'll try and be objectively even-handed. Raspberry Pi is less expensive. Raspberry Pi sold 1 million units last year. Raspberry Pi has just a wonderfully enthusiastic, loyal, relatively young, education-oriented base, but they're also putting these things up in space on weather balloons and stuff like that, right? It's got a lot of software that does run on it. It's got a lot of example projects that are out there where people got robotics things going and all kinds of things. Those are all good things about it. And they were kind of out there and they made this dream of low-cost computing, I think, a reality. Big downside is it does have binary blobs. It's not fully open source, and so one of the things that I'm personally interested in doing stuff with webcams, right? at least the word on the street is, it's not real good with webcams. Why is that? Well, don't know, you know, can't really find out.
The graphics processors. I mean, ARM 11 is going on 6 years old. It's original design. That's why it's cheap. And it's great that it's cheap and it's available to so many people. And that's awesome. But you shouldn't expect it to be something that...
Substantially older processor. I don't know what it has for memory on board, but it's nothing like the...
256 megabyte, 2512.
Yeah.
On the upgraded version.
No HDMI.
Yeah,
it does. Does it have HDMI?
It has composite and HDMI.
HDMI.
HDMI is
in that. Another thing is, like, for instance, one of the cool things that they've just recently announced, I don't think it's shipped yet, is a camera board for like $25. Has it shipped yet? They started taking orders yesterday. It looks really cool. And $25. It's a separate, it's like a daughter board. You plug it in. The BeagleBone has all kinds of really cool real-time processing capabilities. Is a process, is that what they refer to it as? Where you can just directly connect in cameras. Probably similar to the way in which they've done it with the Raspberry Pi, I'm guessing. But if you want to do custom stuff with the Raspberry Pi, once you get past a certain point, the only people who know what happens in the code are the people who essentially work for Broadcom, as I understand it from reading about it, who can make, you know, who are writing the code to do this interfacing stuff. So you really hit a wall pretty quick. Not necessarily true with the BeagleBone stuff. Anyways, that's, I think, a fairly objective comparison.
So the Raspberry Pi.
One more question on that. On the Raspberry Pi, the Ethernet's basically part of the USB subsystem. Is that also true on this thing, or is it actually separate property?
No, I think it's separate. I've only seen that as waged as like kind of, because things start to bog down. You start to, you know, have overloads, basically. You're short on bandwidth. Here's an image of what that bone script thing looks like. Actually, this was the program. So it is retrievable. But what you have to do is you have to take a snapshot, a picture of the screen. So this is the program that I keyed in. And when you run it, what it does is it makes the links, the LEDs blink off and on. But you just got to retype it every time. That's what you do. So this is the, you know, the time thing. I had to install, I had to do old package install, TZ data, had to find out what the zone info was, had to create a symbolic link, had to restart it. But now every time I do an NTP date, you know, time inst whatever, gov, it works, right? Okay, there are books available, only a couple. This one in the bottom, it's a new one, it's not out yet. It's a big, massive, one of the things that's really cool about Texas Instruments is they have fantastic documentation. That's another thing that is terrific about the BeagleBone. Has anybody seen the system reference manual? It's like 100 pages. It's right down to, you know, you get the wiring diagrams, you get the specs, you get the speeds, you get the performance attributes, everything. If you ever wanted to kind of get in at that level of how does this machine work, it's there and it's free, which is really pretty cool. And there are a couple of books coming out. O'Reilly has an early release of one that they're working on. This guy, Matt Richardson, has done a lot of, I think he's out of New York, really novel kind of applications with the BeagleBone. The other thing is with those headers, whereas the, I don't know if what the Raspberry Pi has, the Arduino, they have these boards, right, that you can put. So they call
the
them
shields.
The shields, right, the Arduino shields. For the BeagleBone, they're called capes.
But they're cross-compatible. It's the exact same size, so technically
right.
They could be used.
Right. So if anybody comes back on Sunday, we'll have a number that we'll actually be showing, assuming FedEx.
I'm not finding that.
What's that?
I'm not finding that. I pulled that up and it says the request article is not currently available.
I might have the inside track on that one, John. Sorry. Anyways, we'll come back to that. Okay. So. This is now kind of the three parts to this presentation. So anybody who was here last month, we talked about Android sticks and these little devices that have, all of them came from China, and were made with chips from China, the Rock chip, Allwinner chip, a couple of others. And we said, boy, this is a really cool, they were like $50, $75, and typically what they were used for, they ran Android. A few of them had been allowed modification by clever hackers to install some variant of something that looked like Linux, right? And, you know, I had some moderate, limited, very limited success in actually getting a version of Linux, Ubuntu, up and running on this. But at the end of the meeting, we talked about what would be theoretically, hypothetically, sort of the ideal Linux box, right? Not a high-end thing that's going to, you know, launch satellites into space, but something that if somebody wanted to either educate themselves on Linux or toy around with Linux or, you know, build a remote-controlled garbage can with Linux that they could use. So, you know, hypothetically, Kurt and I kicked some ideas around and I came up with this name, BLU Micro, right? So last month it was a picture, and actually this month it's a prototype. So we just coincidentally, we had, here's the packaging. It actually, you know, says BLU Micro for anybody. We have the spray paint if anybody wants to, you know, to make it blue, right? And so I just saw it today. I don't know if anybody saw it. We'll pass this around. It's not, you can't, you know, do much with it. Don't break your fingernails on it. But I just saw, like, yesterday that Microsoft's, they've got a release, an update coming out called BLU. Is that what it is? And I told Kurt, see, there they go.
Well, they changed that now. It's now called 8.1.
Oh, they dropped the BLU. Did IBM get out of the system or what? It's code name. So last month it was sort of an idea, and this month it's actually a package. So we've got the thing for the Ethernet and the power and HDMI and the USB, and it's also got an SD card in it, and then it's got two USBs, right? It's got the on the go and the other thing, and then. What you do is you know, so it's not screwed in yet. The screws haven't come yet. But so, you know, it kind of fits in there.
Like a matchbox size.
Yeah, it's just, you know, you could. So all of a sudden you've got a device that you know, costs a little bit more now because it's got an enclosure, but, you know, still not that much more.
So is it based on BeagleBone?
It's the same. It's the case is based on a BeagleBone model that was put out there. So the short story of it is that. That my college roommate, you know, months ago, we talked on the phone. And he said, geez, my kid's out in Chicago, and he's just graduated from college. And, you know, can you believe what he's doing? He's, like, working on a 3D printer startup. This guy's a lawyer, right? And so, coincidentally, well, anyways. So, and I said, well, that's interesting. You know, there'll be a time for that, right? The maker revolution is about to come. So after last month's meeting, I called the guy back up and I said, is he still doing that 3D printer thing, right? And so he actually is. And they took the basic design that I sent them. The name of the company is Isis 3D. And they'll be shipping a printer sometime at the end of May. This is actually a demo. Does anybody use SolidWorks? You know how to use it?
Yeah, I actually in that binder, I have some MacWorks.
Oh, cool. So maybe you can come on up then, you can show a little demo of, so people can see the case, actually. So these guys are working on a 3D printer. One of the applications, actually, for the BeagleBone that they sort of they publicized for are 3D printers. And so kind of what's happening is, in the same way that we're seeing this reduction in pricing for these devices, these folks are targeting, I mean, a lot of the 3D printers, I don't know if they used to be $50,000, and, you know, there was a big breakthrough that got it down to $10,000, and these folks are just looking at another, you know, multiple drop in pricing on that kind of stuff. It was designed with the SolidWorks application, which we'll kind of look at in a minute, and then we're going to go to this thing. So the other half of the usefulness of BeagleBone is that basically it is really just a standalone computer. Okay, so whereas this device is tethered to the laptop or to a computer via a USB, what we actually have over here, and if we, you know, cross our fingers and the networking gods are with us, is a standalone one of these devices, and I'll just describe what it does and we can show it later. But with a couple of programming languages, so it beautifully runs a program that I compiled in C++ using this stuff called OpenCV. OpenCV is Open Computer Vision. And so what I did is I developed just a couple of files on a big beefy machine that, you know, that costs many thousands of dollars and wastes, you know, dozens of watts of electricity. So I did some stuff on that, and then I took that same exact C++ code, moved it over to this little box, just G++, and boom, 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 and it just, you know, chugged right through. And again, this isn't millions of lines of code. So it actually, it wasn't like I had to wait for very long at all, right? So you hit the button, it goes through it, it chugs through it, and it compiles. So what that application does is it just basically goes out to the webcams, which is something that I wasn't very hopeful I was going to be able to successfully complete with the Raspberry Pi. Just based upon what I'd heard, it seemed OpenCV comes installed on this device as part of the Angstrom release, which is pretty good. And then the other thing that I have running on this over here is a web server. And the web server is written in Dart. Anybody know what Dart is? So Dart is this very unknown language out of Google that obviously hasn't yet made it. Although it did make it to that list. Is it, how do you, Tagobi or Tygo? Or there's a list of the top programming languages that you know, comes out. It's updated monthly. And Dart did make it onto the top 50. So like the first five are, any guesses? I mean, Java, C, C++, Python's up there probably in the top 10. What am I missing? You know, C# or something like that, right? So somewhere in there is Dart. So Dart is a language which, again, for anybody who's interested in the software side of things, I would highly encourage you to go take a look at. Essentially what it is Google has said, we're developing all these applications like Gmail, and anybody use Drive? There are so many cool applications out there. The RSVP application that we're using for the ARM Festival on Sunday, it's a free available application. So what Google has done is they've developed all these really elaborate applications that need to be compatible with JavaScript. They need to run in a browser, okay? And so the question is, how do you do it? And they've come up with a couple of different ways to, they got a couple different tools, but they've got a group of people off working on this Google Dart. It's an open source language, it's called Dart, but Google's the principal developers. The people who are developing this are the same folks who developed the JavaScript V8 engine. People know what V8 is? So about 4 or 5 years ago, Google figured out how to make more money, how to make the web, by making the web faster, letting people get around the web more quickly. And so what they did is they said, well, one of the real bottlenecks right now in the performance of the web is the engine that processes the JavaScript, right? So they hired some really sharp people who have done, they've done like some of the Java stuff, I think, and they know how to do VMs, virtual machines, which are essentially engines, software engines that run in your computer, and they do real-time interpretation of scripting language. You know, so they've got just-in-time compilation and all this other kind of stuff. So they set these people off to work around the time Chrome was being first developed. And I know this is boring to people, but this is really cool. Anyways, one of the reasons Chrome is so fast is because the V8 engine that interprets and processes all this JavaScript inside is so optimized that your browsers just fly. They open sourced that, they made it available. I think Mozilla has picked it up. I don't know to what extent Microsoft has picked it up, sorry, but.
They're closing it.
But what's that?
So today was the first day of Google I.O.
Yeah.
And so now they're having a bunch of new things. Basically, a compression proxy, they have WebP, a bunch of other things, but they're closing off a lot of those things and having it strictly within Google's platform.
Yeah.
So their WebP, which is their image compression format, that's staying open source, and V8, the current existing code, is staying open source, but all optimizations are going to be like Chrome only.
Yeah, so, you know,
Google was very benevolent up until Google Plus came out.
Up until it's adopted. So, partly too is that, and you can't blame them. The other thing, Thomas mentioned this WebP thing, right, which is essentially a more optimal picture format, image format, JPEG. JPEG has lots of, it has some patent encumbrances. It's not a patent-free technology. What's that?
The patents have not expired.
GIFs that expired.
I'm not a patent attorney, so I don't know. But certainly historically, it has been an issue, right? And it seems like maybe it still is an issue. So,
are you talking about a still image format?
A still image format, JPEG.
Okay, I was familiar with WebNorm, which is pretty good.
Right, so
WebP is still pretty good.
Right, so WebP is an improved optimized image format. WebM is an improved optimized video format.
So WebP and WebM both offer about 50% compression ratio, while still being lossless.
Right.
So, and actually they just announced that there's going to be both a glossy and lossless version of WebP. And Facebook and Google are both adopting it as of today.
How does WebP compare to PNG?
It's just, I mean, it's lossless, but it still has that 50% compression ratio.
PNG
it goes, exactly, but it's 50% smaller than PNG.
So smaller file, and again, in Google's best interest, the more stuff we can ship around the web, the more, you know, access people have to the web, the more advertisements people can see, and the better the business model is. I've done a fair amount of stuff with the WebM. Again, open source, code's available, you can download it, you can compile it, you can read it. There's really a lot that's, you know, at some point in time, if it gets closed off, it gets closed off, but it's still usable. So anyways, to continue the saga on, and wrap it up. So this device basically is a programmable computer. I mean, that's the short of it, right? So, and the reason Dart is a very interesting, so Dart actually is principally being developed on the x86 platform. So there are lots of people out there, they're not here, but there are lots of people out there who are doing development of substantial applications in Dart. The advantages of Dart, basically, it's a robust development environment. JavaScript has lots of ugly corners where normal people can get lost pretty quick. It's not the easiest thing to develop large scale applications in. Google is one company that's developing lots of large scale applications. So what they've done is they've developed this language, and it can run in two modes. One mode is it essentially compiles the Dart language, which is kind of a mix of C and C++ and small, but it's a developer-friendly language. One mode is you can spit out JavaScript, and then people can just run the JavaScript, right? So there's no disruption in there. The other mode is actually it spits out a more optimized sort of, you know, it's not a bytecode, but again, what they've taken the VA team has developed a Dart virtual machine that interprets this language natively, and it's been ported to a couple different platforms, right? So you can run it on Linux, you can run it on Macintosh, you can run it on Windows, and I've run it on ARM. And the way I ran it on ARM was to take the Dart compiler and the tool chain. So now you've got large scale capable tool chains that run on Linux, x86, under Ubuntu, stuff that we're familiar with. And you can then grab the open source Dart code. And if you've got stomach for it, you can feed that into this cross-compile tool chain, and you can actually compile a version that will run on ARM. And then you pick up that binary, and you put it on that little ARM machine over there, and all of a sudden now you can run Dart programs on the BeagleBone Black. Now, the caveat is it's very early release. There were lots of, you know, of caveats of, you know, no big program's going to work. My initial goal was actually just, if I could do a hello world on this BeagleBone Black in Dart, you know, I thought that would be pretty cool. So that, and then before I knew it, I was running a web server. And it's like, really? And then, you know, before I knew it, I was just grabbing images off of the little BeagleBone Black connected to a webcam, all with the same code that basically runs on the Linux platform. So the beauty, again, of this device is not only can you basically experiment with this bone script, and, you know, kids or educational people could just basically attach this little $45 device to a desktop computer, and all of a sudden they're able to experience this whole new world of, you know, Arduino-like, Raspberry Pi-like devices. But in addition, you can disconnect it, you can plug in a power supply, you can hook it up to the Ethernet, and you can slap in an SD card, and you can put it up on your HDMI screen, and before you know it, you're really, you know, you're surfing the web, you write your own programs, and it still doesn't cost more than $45, unless you buy the case. So that's really that's the whole pitch here. So, you know, this is like, you know, this is the plea for my kids' summer vacation project. Say you want to buy these cases because, and the other thing is we'll get these ISIS guys to hurry up and ship their printers. So, So that's, I think that, so the Coyote Cam, which will, you know, we'll figure out, Kurt, if we can make this thing work. All you really have to do is, this sets up a web browser. The browser has to be on the same sort of subnet, and then the web server has to be on the same subnet, and then the browser is able to access that. And it, so it grabs images there, and then it sort of shuffles them over to a browser. But the nice thing is, and again, this is why I bought 8 of them, because you know, you can have these little devices. They could be dash cams. You could watch the, there's a pretty cool website down at the Harvard site, the hawk cam. Has anybody seen the hawk cam? There's like a hawk that's, you know, given birth to, and you got the nest and they got the webcam. So there's environmental stuff that's of interest. You can watch the garden grow. There are a lot of different things you can do once you've got, you know, fairly low cost devices. Any questions that you, yeah?
Did I read that the price of the BeagleBone was $90 and they cut it in half?
They did. So I don't know, what did you pay for yours? The, it was like 90, right, yeah.
So why did they, was it competition from the Raspberry Pi that they said, oh, sell these at 90?
No, well, it was, it was one of the reasons they dropped the JTAG, which was the cost, right? And the other thing is actually, they, you asked about memory, the 512, so they went to DDR3, which is faster, but costs about half the price. You know, how can life be any better? More memory, faster, for less. So what they did is they went through, and you know, they clearly have figured out ways to, well, the, another big thing is that, you know, they really had a lot of demand early on from the, you know, from distributors to buy these things. So they were able to produce, to basically put orders in for the BeagleBone Black at a larger scale. And, you know, chips and everything. I mean, when you buy stuff in volume, all of a sudden it just costs way, a lot less. I got these boards, they're about half a dozen or so distributors who have them for sale. I bought these from Element 14, and even though the website showed that they were out of stock, they, you know, they shipped them within, I think I got the first batch within about 2 weeks, and then I bought some more because they had like a weekend special for free shipping. So actually on that, I, you know, but yeah, you're right, they pretty much cut the price in half, but there, it wasn't completely in response to Raspberry Pi, because, the, you know, they've probably been working on this design for quite some time. And yeah, sorry.
Can you hook it up to a tablet, a Samsung 10, sure. Nexus 10?
Nexus 10.
In what way?
Nexus, in the so, same way.
Oh, you can try. I mean, that's, yeah. See so what happens.
So you need to have an OTG connector. So I have Nexus 10 as well. You actually have to root it to be able to get it.
Yeah, this isn't rooted.
It was really dumb because of, like, I had the Zoom before that and the Nexus 7, and it works fine without it, but the Nexus 10, you need to root to get access to that, which is really dumb.
I passed this thing around, but it probably wouldn't come back, right? But yeah, I'll pass it around, because this is actually worth seeing.
And if software, if you don't want to mess with software, you can mess with hardware. The Gerber files are available for this. If you want to get in the business of competing with TI.
Well, I don't think.
So what else? What did we, what other questions? Yeah?
Can you connect to the Sandel drive?
Say that again?
Can you connect to the Sandel drive?
Yeah, I can, in fact, if we could get that going. And that raises a good question, right? So one of the things I wasn't able to figure out, for some reason I couldn't run applications off of the SD card. So you know, I compiled this little C++ application. I wanted to just run it right off of the, and it would not allow me to switch the permission on, and so it must be like a Linux thing or an Angstrom thing that says, SD media, you don't really want to run out. It doesn't make sense to me, but I couldn't do it. So, and the other thing is when I compiled Dart, it was bigger than I had space for on the eMMC card. So I plugged in just the normal SATA drive, and it just works fine.
So it has a SATA port on
it? Well, it's USB on,
USB,
you know.
SATA, okay.
But it's, you know, it's got to be SATA in the middle somewhere, and behind the, under the cover. Is that what you're, I mean, it's a USB drive. I take that back. There's no SATA sort of onboard Yeah, but they're, you know, USB, right? It's,
there are other small boards that have SATA ports.
Yeah.
The Arndale board.
Which one?
Yeah.
The Arndale board.
Oh, right, yeah.
Only 100, huh?
You know, it's only $45, huh? I mean, I don't know, how much is, how much more does it cost for a gigabit connector?
$12, really?
Gigabit.
Yeah.
Is the standard now. It really makes no sense that they're to ship something with one.
I'll ask, just out of curiosity. I don't know.
It's a power thing.
It's a power thing.
It's a power thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, there's only 5 watt ports.
5 more.
I mean, I think the power's a pop-up just because of, there's plenty of five watt ports.
That's a good question. Come back Sunday, we might have an answer. I don't know. That's a good question. I figured it was cost, but
it
could be
power. Right, because your signal integrity things come
you probably need another
your
chip. Yeah.
So it does significantly add to the cost.
Yeah. Great question, though. What else? You can't expand the memory. You're kind of, you know, but that's just going to keep getting better. You know, Linux doesn't, my experience, you don't need gigabytes and gigabytes to do useful things, and it's all a question of what you might, what applications do people envision they might actually consider? Any?
Yeah. What about Macaulay 2?
What's that?
That's a mathematical language. Like main.
Is it open source?
Yes.
You know, I'd download the Ubuntu cross-compile chain, see if you can compile it, and see what happens. Ubuntu, not the latest release, but the recent LTS release. This was the one, I don't know what the, so what would it be,
12.04.
Is 12.04
the most recent LTS? Yeah.
It's called Precise.
Right. Precise, yes. Right. So, and what's the one since then?
There's been two.
There's been two.
12.10, 12.13.04.
Okay. So 12.04 is the one, Precise, that you got to download to get the cross-compile toolchain stuff. So I take it back. In order to get the cross-compile, the Dart, and essentially what they do, I think, is they piggyback on the Chromium sort of toolchain, and they've got all sorts of, you know, macro script type things that are precise. So precise is the way to go with that, if you want to do that. But you could try it. I certainly have, I mean, the C++ stuff is fine for little things. The Dart, I'm just, you know, agog at. They're going to spend a couple of months they're working on the performance tuning enhancements for the ARM platform specifically. And maybe there'll be some stuff at Google I.O. Google I.O. is happening now, is that right? Today
was the first day, and tomorrow is technically every day, but they only really do stuff.
There are definitely a couple of sessions on Dart, and one of them is live stream, I think.
All the sessions are live stream this year.
Interesting, because they, from what I read, there was one of the four Dart sessions that was going to be live streamed. They were all going to be recorded, but only one was going to be live broadcast. They're not making money yet in Dart, so I guess they got to. What else? Any other questions? Any other applications? I mean, what applications could you use? Yeah.
HTPC, home theater PC.
Yeah, sure.
I was always looking for a small platform, couldn't find any Windows platforms. Failed at building Chrome OS. So.
Yeah, right.
Does it have hardware decode though?
Hardware what?
It doesn't.
Not the Sitara.
That's why you could look at like the Odory, probably the U2, just because it's extremely small. Because that has a Mali 400. What's the really cheap part? Exynos 5. What's the really cheap?
So for me, the threshold was, it had to be under $100, preferably under $50, and this hit my sweet spot. Another thing is just like a NAS, a network, you know, kind of a home server, kind of where you know, you don't necessarily have to be putting stuff up on the TV, but just to have a shared server device that you can store files on and do, you know, and anything that you might envision scripting or network updating or, you know, getting the weather reports, or you probably could turn off your computers, some of your bigger, beefier computers, and just let this one run all the time, and you'd be really happy. I mean, it's you'd probably have fun developing apps for it too. So, anything else? Otherwise, we're gonna turn you back, Stephen. How do you buy the cases? This, he's a plant. He's definitely a plant. I don't know. you know? I think, I hope as soon as these are available, right? These guys are going to ship the end of May, and then we're going to, actually, well, there's a website, BLU Micro, BLU, you'll remember those letters, right? And no E, and Micro, BlueMicro.com. And, you know, we have thought about actually bundling the boards with a case and maybe an HDMI cable because, you know, you could use it, right? Just as a convenience thing and see what we can do with it. So we have some ideas of how. So that would be the place to find out. Thank you for asking.
Does ISIS have blue polymer?
They do, but we have an exclusive on that, so don't get any ideas. they do. In fact, it doesn't cost any more in BLU, and that's what it's going to be.
Good.
Yeah, but they do. So it's a small startup, very smart people, and, you know, keep your eyes open.
Can they make guns with firing pins?
Yeah. We won't be selling those, though. Firing pins are extra. Yeah, that was in the news, right? So you want to talk about that?
No. I mean, they pulled down the website.
Yeah, there's
on export grounds. Yeah. If they block foreign IP addresses, it'd be legal.
Yeah.
So the solution is to print out the design and like they did for PGP and ship it as a book overseas.
That's what they did with PGP. Pirate Bay already has a scarf copy.
All right, never mind.
Yeah. So t-shirts on that too. Yeah.
This
is a gun.
The internet treats censorship as a bug and runs around.
But I think we will sell something, and I hope that it will be by summertime. Otherwise, my kids are going to be cutting the grass a lot. What else? Any other questions or?
How to make it wireless?
Real easy. You know, $7 dongle, USB dongle. I mean, why the chip doesn't have wireless, and you know, it doesn't today, but it will tomorrow. Is what I would suspect, right? So, I haven't done it yet, but I mean, there are wireless USB connectors that are real cheap. And I'm sure it works fine. It's, you know, really, that's the nice thing. It's just a vanilla distribution. And so much stuff now is in the core Linux stream, right? That, you know, like the webcam stuff and just all the support. The other thing I should, I ranted a little bit at the last meeting about, you know, despite still holding Intel stock in small quantities, that you know, where have they been in terms of power efficient, you know, computing, right? And so maybe you've seen it, but in the past week, is it Silvermont?
Silvermont.
That was, maybe you can describe it, what was announced.
It's basically their next generation Atom architecture, and they've done a bunch of enhancements. Keeping the power budget the same, essentially their performance will be much better. At least, so they claim. I work for the competitor, so I don't know what to do.
Can we turn the camera on his shirt right now? speak honestly.
But it's supposed to be good. Perfectly good. AMD has stuff coming.
AMD does have stuff coming.
Is that an official say?
Yes. It's going to be announced this summer.
So this I think is market forces at play, right? Mm-hmm. And this is where Raspberry Pi should, you know, they should receive some kind of Nobel Prize for something or other, because what you do have is, you know, did TI cut the price in half from the previous BeagleBone in response, or just because they had better, more, they clearly thought harder, it seems, about how to reduce the price and cut out chips where they don't need them absolutely. You know, and hopefully, Intel and AMD and other people will come along, whether it's Samsung, and make available devices like this that can be used for educational purposes, for applicational purposes.
One of the things I think TI has been very good at is marketing a lot of their products. So they have some marketing experience there. Again, consumer marketing.
Anything else? Questions, thoughts? Kurt, you want to give a pitch for Sunday's agenda? We'll bring it up here so you can see it.
So the genesis of this thing, there's a big conference in Boston starting Monday, the IPBPS conference. So there's going to be zillions of computer scientists in town starting Monday. So if traffic is clogged by large crowds of people walking across the BU bridge, because there's no food over the Hyatt Regency, you'll know what group they're with. So we called a bunch of them up and we said, you know, if you're here the weekend before IPBPS, can come and talk. One is this Gaurav Mitra cat from Australian National University. Is that what they use this for? So he does a lot of work with the TI Keystone 2 family of processors, and he's got a little OpenCL going on. He'll be a very interesting talk. And he's here. There's 20 workshops associated with the IPDPS conference. So he's going to speak at the Ashes conference, and we got him to come in a day early to talk to us. And we'll get. You know, besides Shankar, we're going to get a guy talk about the hybrid, the heterogeneous architecture. There's an affinity group, the HSA organization. I think so. He's been talking to them. We didn't get somebody from HSA, but I know AMD is a subscriber, and so the heterogeneous topics are getting very interesting because You know, what Brian and I have talked about tonight, when you buy some ARM-branded processor, you're going to get something else in it. You know, you're going to get somebody's GPU, you're going to probably get, you know, certainly when you buy AMD Fusion, you've got GPU in there. What TI wants you to buy is a processor that's got DSP in it as well. So you can do some pretty clever stuff when it's all in the same silicon. And some of these programmers that work with the APIs and the SDKs will be able to talk to you about some tips and tricks. So that should be a lot of fun, and TI because we're busy evangelizing BeagleBone, so they buy lunch for us.
It should so TI is gonna foot bill for some lunch, and there are some giveaways that we'll have for door prizes and all.
What does BeagleBone come up?
The BeagleBone.
The BeagleBone Black.
BeagleBone Black. So the recap is. There was a BeagleBone, which was the first one, different chips, different configuration. You can find out the details online, and a lot more money, right? Was the first one?
It was 165. It was 2009.
Right. So it was almost $200, and it was only a couple of years ago. So the price has fallen pretty precipitously, which is good. And then I had the Panda board, which we did a few years back. That was different processor, arguably more powerful. Was it dual core or?
Panda board was dual core on that 40. So the Beagle board was on that 3530. It was 700 megahertz to 1 gigahertz, single core. The Panda board was on that 4430, and that was 1.0 to 1.2 gigahertz dual core. And then on that 5 was TI.
You know, the Panda board is a little bit faster than the Panda board ES.
The ES is 1.2.
And, you know, somewhere along the way, the question about wireless, I think one of them added wireless.
So the Panda wireless. Board, both Panda boards have wireless. It was actually integrated into the SoC.
Yeah. So the beauty of it is, I mean, maybe someday they'll just, you know, somebody will drop that in. Maybe it'll be Intel. Maybe it'll be AMD. Maybe it'll be somebody else. And
TI and Qualcomm have been the only two to do that. And with TI getting out of just getting rid of all that.
The commodity.
Yeah, it's Qualcomm's the only player doing it. Samsung, well, I don't know why.
NVIDIA's going to come out. Tegra 4i.
Oh, yeah. Well, and Samsung is, you're saying, the better GPU? Samsung's.
No, I'm talking about Samsung having integrated wireless.
Oh.
So the thing, you know, so you NVIDIA, right? So these are people who make graphics chips. So you're saying that they're going to come out with basically a general processor that would. Be
well, their ARM, the Tegra stuff is ARM plus their GPU.
Yep.
So that's what is in the Nexus 7, for instance.
Yep.
So their next generation, which is Tegra 4, will have a Tegra 4i variant where they, I don't know what radios are going to be in it, but definitely Wi-Fi. I don't know if LTE baseband.
The i is just LTE. It does not.
It's LTE, right? It's not Wi-Fi.
It doesn't have Wi-Fi, so. Really, Qualcomm's the only one which actually has Wi-Fi, Bluetooth,
correct.
And CDMA or LTE in one. in the SoC itself.
So that's why, so for instance, the Samsung Galaxy S4 for the US has
it's the
Qualcomm Snapdragon S4 because that has all the stuff. So because everywhere else you only need to sell a GSM version for the US, the Qualcomm one has both CDMA and GSM, so it's one chip to do it.
So the beauty of something like this is for all these vendors, if you bump into any of these people who are making these chips and, you know, making these decisions, encourage them to come out with devices like this, low-cost boards that people can use for experimentation, for education, for in-home use, for, you know, kinds of stuff that isn't going to, it's not going to cannibalize their markets for higher-end, higher-performance applications. But they'll, you know, sell a lot more of these low power chips for all sorts of, I think, applications that people haven't yet dreamed of. So
we're going to do some hardware hacking before then?
I will do some hardware hacking for anybody who's interested in them. That's all. Thank you. Appreciate it.